We have a great, great opportunity with those truck stops at Dulles Airport. And what concerns me about that is they have to connect to a health system. So we've got to get Metro up to speed before we connect our Metro stops to them. Or it's, we're wasting an opportunity. So I am all for bringing the federal government and all the jurisdictions together and finding a solution to Metro. I think it goes to infrastructure spending. If we had a major federal infrastructure spending or source, and there are two proposals right now in Congress, in the Senate, our only Senator Rockefeller has the Bridge Act. It's a bipartisan act. It's a way of aggregating money, some public, some private, that would be lent out across the country for infrastructure projects. It's a very good proposal. In the House, John Delaney has a similar proposal. His is kind of interesting. It has an interesting twist. It involves allowing corporations who have profits abroad that they won't bring back because they have to pay an additional 15% tax because our corporate tax rates are high. And allowing them to bring that money back tax-free if they agree to lock it up, you know, lend it out for infrastructure improvements for 10 years for a fixed period of time of 1%. So I think that's kind of interesting because it doesn't involve any taxpayer money. It's just bringing this, you know, we forego that 15% tax on this money, but they're not bringing it back anyway, so it's not sending it back. So yes?
Let me ask, how much of spending on Metro? I was under the assumption that we've spent quite a lot on our DC Metro, but somehow we're not maybe spending well. Is that
probably a combination of both, but right now it's in such disrepair of being capital needs.
Yes.
So we have to have an infusion of capital. I think the only way this is going to work is if the federal government plays a real role in getting Metro up to speed. I do think Metro has to, you know, certainly look at its operations and improve and become more efficient. But we've got some real repairs to do, and there's hardly a week that goes by that we don't hear of something. And, you know, that's, we've just got to get it fixed. I mean, we have the fourth largest Metro system in the country. So Metro needs to be repaired, and we've just got to find a solution. So transportation and education are two things that I really believe in because they're investments in our country. Both of them return money to us. When you invest, it's very different than just spending. And there's, I mean, business you understand that it's really important to invest. And that's what I believe education and transportation are. Of course, we all want safe and secure communities. And we have to be vigilant about protecting our communities. We need to get our intelligence communities to cooperate with us so that we really get our arms around a lot of these incidents that we're seeing. And we're going to do it. So we have to do that. That's the government's job to do that. And I'm committed to making sure that our communities are safe. I'm a big believer in to address climate change. The climate is changing. We can argue about why, but it is changing. And it does have ramifications on all of us. And I do worry about the next generation. I was appointed by then Governor Tim Kaine to his Climate Change Commission here in Virginia. This was a nonpartisan commission, and I would have been on as a business member. He had members of the business community, members of both sides of the government, both parties, and the utilities, and every stakeholder involved to discuss the issue of climate change and how we can, you know, protect the Commonwealth. One issue we have that's really serious and unique is Norfolk is the biggest military base in the country, and the sea level rise on our coast is a really serious thing. I just participated in all of a sudden stopped going there. So they've had a 10-year drought, it created civil unrest, and from that, you know, we've got what we've got now. It's growing in children, a serious thing. And they say, we said, our U.S. military is the 911 of the world. And they're getting calls, you know, more and more calls from all over the world to come in and help solve conflicts, you know, and fix problems. And so many of them are rooted, really, in a change in our climate. So it's something we have to acknowledge and address, and the United States needs to take the leadership role in this. I believe in equal pay for women. I think if women do the same work as men, guys, you know, I think that's kind of common sense. It's not only fair, though, it's an economic issue. Three-quarters of all of our families with children have a woman working. Many of them are single breadwinners, and many of them are co-breadwinners. But it's taking resources away from our families. And so we need to have equal pay.
So when I Right, yeah.
It's a special thing, and I think that particularly are to the actual.
There's a referendum for one of the county schools, the public schools that have been on. So, they did it last election in November, and it helped also get the voters in and out of the schools where most of the polling places are.
And maybe we can engage our business communities, you know, and they can kind of let their workers know it's important and give them a little bit of flexibility so they can go vote during the day and kind of ease up the restrictions on election day. Our business community would be that happy.
So I disagree. I think that the community is positive and working with the school. I think it should be easier.
I mean, your first husband was not a politician, so you didn't have interest in politics at that particular point.
Oh, we had lots of interest in politics.
You did?
It was kind of okay. A lot of people, you know, no, we were always very interested in politics, just not, and we always voted, but we weren't engaged in politics. I think he did a lot of politics.
I was just wondering, as a woman, how difficult it is to be in the political field.
You're talking to a woman who's in the construction business. So, you know, that's not exactly a female friendly business either. I don't know. I don't find it particularly difficult. And maybe that's just because I've always been in the business. But no, I don't find it. It's harder. You know, we have to worry about our hair. And things that guys don't have to worry about their time is scheduling. The Lauren is my scheduler. She's corrected this in a lot of ways. That I need a little bit more time between things sometimes. Sometimes I'm, you know, I'm helping a nonprofit, you know, scrub kitchen, and then I go into something where I have to be dressed up, and she gets that. So there are little things, just practical things like that, but I don't know.
What was the question?
What's about
what are the boundaries of the 10th district? Parts of Fairfax County. Yeah, that is north of Northern McLean, Great Falls, that it wraps around Herman and Weston. That goes to Jerry Thomas, just to be like, wraps around and it picks up areas like Clifton, Manassas City, Manassas Park, and a few counties that it goes into Brazil. It's all of Flagler County, all of Clark County, all of Frederick County, including Winchester City, and then, you know, about 5 or 6 in Brazil County.
Metal,
paper blocks. We go, or it all goes in the bucket.
And you think to yourself, how does it come about the other side? Like, you know, how do they separate from all of this? How do they really recycle? I'm sure I'm not the only person that worries about this. It's like, I really wonder why we're so disconnected with the fact that, you know, we have one planet, there must be limited resources, it can't go on forever, but we seem likely unconcerned about it. And I wonder, you know, are you not finding that there's less resonance than you would hope for?
I see progress. I really do. I see a lot of progress. And, you know, certainly our cars are getting better, energy we're seeing more and more use of renewables and different technologies. And frankly, I think there's an enormous opportunity in the green economy for manufacturing of solar panels.
They've just widened 50. We just know that, but it's going to be a short time before that's full. There are buses that go from here into the city. There are really limited infrastructure. We seem highly reactive in this area. I don't even understand how we would get over that. Like, what can we, what even from a legislative or you know, how do they solve that?
This goes to this issue. If we had a way of funding infrastructure, we wouldn't be quite so reactive. We wait till something's really, really bad to fix it because it costs hundreds. And if we had a source to borrow from variable rates and fix the infrastructure, I think we'd see us get ahead of the curve. But we're not beyond the intent to be reactive. Transportation in metropolitan regions is something that we have to work with
talking with them and their
fascinating
friends.
Kids.
They're very apathetic. they believe our political system is a joke. Because they get, how many calls a night do you get? This is Hillary Clinton. This is Trump. This is whoever calling them. And you know it's just a robocall. And my son asked me the other day, why should I vote? Because it's all based on money. Whoever has the most money usually wins the election. And we certainly are going that same way now with everybody talking about how much money Hillary has raised, how much money Trump hasn't raised. And it seems like it's all about money. And the money buys negative ads. It doesn't put any issues out the forefront. How can we change that? I'm almost to the point, I know this is not necessary, I would give each candidate, here's whatever the sum is, $50 million. Spend it how you want. Once it's gone, it's gone. You know, because I don't want a blitz for the last 8 weeks of political TV ads. And I think we're ruining our kids because our kids see it and they realize it's a joke. You know, because my son said to me, well, let's see who raises the most money. And that shouldn't be what an 18-year-old kid is talking about. We should look at the issues. Well, why is money such a big issue and not the real problem? I just hope we end up seeing it as a country that we are turning our younger generation to move this country forward. In 20 years, they're going to be the movers and the shapers. We're turning them off.
But there does need to be some.
some field on that issue of how we deal with our immigrants who are here. And many, many, not most, the majority of them are good people trying to do the best for their family, just like you. And all of them are in bad situations. So I am for this comprehensive approach. And it's so everybody's not going to like it.
Hey, how's about regulating something that really kills people, like prescription drugs? You know, I don't know the numbers, but I bet the prescription opiates kill far more people than non-medical marijuana.
Thank you. Thank you very much. You could have stayed longer. It's their fault.
Yeah.